Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 13679 in the name of Kate Forbes on Scottish Government priorities growing the economy. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on the Deputy First Minister, Kate Forbes, to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 11 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. When I took up the role of Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for the Economy in Gaelic 6 weeks ago, I believe, although the election has somewhat distracted us all, I was asked about my plans and priorities. I said then, and I reiterate today, that the plan is simple. The plan is to get the economy firing on all cylinders and to use the engine of economic growth to power a better future. Whilst the plan is simple, the prize is enormous. A country where growth is recognised as a key enabler of social, economic and cultural progress, where economic success enables us to eradicate the scourge of child poverty, to achieve net zero and to provide our public services with the investment they require to save, to empower and to transform lives. Today we publish our latest progress report on the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. And we remain committed to the vision that it describes of a fairer, greener and wealthier economy that works for all the people of Scotland. It's a plan to transform our economy through a relentless climb to the top rather than a self-defeating race to the bottom, by looking outwards to what can be achieved rather than inwards to what we mustn't lose. Scotland's growth needs to be fair, green and sustainable. Growth defined by a spirit of innovation, where the traditional bedrocks of our economy, tourism, financial services, food and drink, reinvent themselves for a digital and net zero world. Growth that is founded on the industries of tomorrow, such as space, fintech, life sciences and advanced manufacturing. The Cabinet Secretary for Health and I recently chaired a roundtable with leaders from the NHS, leading universities and private sector companies looking to develop and scale up new products and services in Scotland. They were clear, not only does Scotland have an incredible history of innovation, but it has the people, the data, the supply chains, the enterprise agencies and the policy makers who can deliver a future that is every bit as successful as our past. I will.
Liz Smith.
She's absolutely correct to say that, but can I ask why it is that the Scottish Government felt the need to cut the budgets for the universities and college sector, who are so instrumental in providing a lot of that research and development and innovation?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the Member is right to say that the colleges and university sector is absolutely critical. I'm about to come on to talk about education and skills. But she'll also recall the fact that our public finances are under extreme strain, that inflation has eroded our ability to spend, and that both of those really are a product of a UK government and Conservative policies. And my hope is that moving forward with the figures for inflation published this morning and a change to the austerity agenda, we might be able to continue to invest in all the public services that matter for Scotland.
Murdo Fraser, why not?
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. I was intrigued to see at the launch of the SNP manifesto this morning, which I believe the Deputy First Minister attended, that the SNP have made spending commitments of £93.8 billion, with tax rises proposed of £70 billion. That leaves a spending black hole of £24 billion. How's that to be filled?
Well, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, Deputy First Minister. I'll take this opportunity, perhaps at this early stage in the proceedings, to remind members, of course, that this debate is about the matters for which this Parliament has responsibility, and we're not going to be engaging in a kind of blatant electioneering extravaganza this afternoon, hopefully. Deputy First
Having
Minister.
Shared multiple platforms with Mr Fraser in various hustings around the country, I'm sure I'll have the opportunity to answer his question more substantively very shortly. So our agenda in this government for economic growth is very much built around our skills and education system that identifies and encourages talent and taps into everybody's potential, not just the privileged few. It tackles the skills gap in computer science by increasing the availability of specialist teaching and encouraging participation in foundational subjects such as maths and physics. It's a system that prepares you to succeed in a world in which AI strikes at the certainties of the established labour market. It will be growth in which everybody has a stake. with regional economic partnerships that define and deliver the priorities of their communities, vibrant social enterprises and an entrepreneurial third sector, a continued commitment to community wealth building and specific programmes that promote enterprise within Gaelic-speaking communities. And it will be growth that respects, protects and celebrates our environment, that recognises our natural resources as an extraordinary competitive advantage, that ensures a just transition and sees public and responsible private investors in Scotland's natural capital working alongside each other to achieve ambitious climate change and biodiversity goals. Realising that potential is not easy. Talking of which, Fergus Ewing.
Fergus Ewing.
I'm most grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. Does she agree that economic growth is not all about more money, more cash? It's also about process, and in particular, speeding up process, whether it's salmon farming consents, new forestry plantations, renewable projects, or planning developments. Does she agree with me that delay is the hidden destroyer of economic growth in Scotland?
Deputy First Minister.
I agree that we need to ensure that Scotland is a great place to do business, and I'll perhaps come on to that, Presiding Officer, with the limited time I have available. Can I say, for the record, that our vision for the economy is ambitious, and achieving it, realising that potential, is not inevitable, nor is it easy. The world is uncertain and unpredictable. But armed with the vision that we first described in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, I believe that we can and will succeed, providing we are prepared to make difficult choices and to commit to sustained action over time. So let me describe some of those choices. We choose to focus on becoming one of the leading start-up economies in Europe. I make no apology for the fact that I am inspired by entrepreneurs. I revel in their optimism, and I want to put their spirit at the heart of Scotland's economic future. And we choose to do this because the economic impact of new and scaling firms is colossal. They are 40% more productive. They are 40% more productive than the economy as a whole, attract investment, create high-paying jobs far beyond the walls of their own enterprises. And in doing so, they help address so many of the wider challenges we face as a country. Companies like Blackford Analysis, a vibrant software company in Edinburgh that uses the power of AI to improve patient outcomes. Intelligent Growth Solutions, a rapidly scaling firm based in Inverkeithing, whose approach to precision farming is at the frontier of the push to deliver global food security. Companies that are growing in Scotland, whose very DNA dispels the myth that growth and well-being are contradictory economic principles. And we make that choice from a position of strength. Last year, and despite the difficult macroeconomic headwinds, our startup ecosystem attracted record investment of almost £1 billion, outperforming all UK regions with the exception of the so-called Golden Triangle between London, Oxford and Cambridge. We recently announced an investment of £5 million in a new enterprise package and are well on our way to delivering one of Europe's finest state-funded systems for creating and scaling high-growth businesses. The £42 million TechScaler network puts the inspiring winds of Silicon Valley into the sails of Scottish innovation, providing world-class incubation facilities and providing founder education from the best providers in the world. And we're expanding our entrepreneurial talent pool by delivering the recommendations of Anna Stewart's Pathways Review. It's simply unacceptable that startups founded by women receive only 2% of investment capital, and we are going to tackle that head-on by creating new, best-in-class environments for women to create and scale businesses, financial incentives to seed good ideas, and structural reforms to the way that the public sector invests in scaling companies. We also choose to put science and technology at the heart of our economic future. We're already a European hub for drug discovery and life sciences and home to the UK's second largest critical technologies supercluster, comprising quantum, photonics, semiconductors and wireless capabilities. It's one of a small number of priority clusters in digital technology, advanced manufacturing, life sciences and the energy transition, which will be supported by a dedicated cluster building programme shaped by industry that will share knowledge and support cross-cluster collaboration. Do I have time?
Yes, there's a bit of time in hand.
Pause, if you don't mind.
Thank the Minister for giving way on Thank the Minister for giving way on that point. She made an important issue about the growth and scaling of firms in Scotland. One of the concerns that's often been raised with me is that firms in Scotland will grow to a certain level, then struggle to access further capital and then have to basically sell into overseas ownership. Is there a strategy in place for the government to try and anchor more firms in Scotland for the longer term so that we can have more FTSE 250 or FTSE 100 companies with headquarters in this country?
The member puts his finger on it when it comes to our ambition for Scottish startups, that in supporting them to start up and then scale up, we don't then want them to leave. And so having that pathway from the moment that they start to the moment that they are extremely successful, we want them to be headquartered in Scotland. And it is part of some of the strategies I've mentioned. And I'm sure I'm very happy to engage on a cross-party basis to make sure that we get it right. Presiding Officer, we want to have a relentless focus on science and technology, and we've developed plans to recast Scotland's world-class universities as hotbeds of start-up creation and scaling through an increased focus on spin-outs, staff and student-led businesses. And we're working through our enterprise agencies and the Scottish National Investment Bank with an investment of over £640 million across 34 investments, which has already helped to drive over £1 billion of third-party co-investment. I do want to make this clear, Presiding Officer, before I come to a conclusion, that the scale of our ambition cannot be met by government-backed funds alone. And that's why, in line with the recommendations of the First Minister's Investor Panel, we have chosen to create a more investment-friendly environment and ecosystem in Scotland. Operating at scale, defining clear roles and responsibilities across the public sector, maintaining a professional and systematic approach to investor engagement, and developing a credible and costed pipeline of investment opportunities. That has already been set out in terms of the £500 million in offshore renewables, which will leverage private investment in ports, manufacturing and assembly work. Presiding Officer, this has to go hand in hand with our vision for fair work, with the number of accredited real living wage employers up from 14 in 2014 to over 3,700 in 2024, and some 67,000 workers in Scotland who have had a pay rise as a result of accreditation. Just under 90% of employees aged 18 and over in Scotland are now paid at least the real living wage, a higher level than that in Wales, England and Northern Ireland. And our median gender pay gap for full-time employees has been lower than the UK as a whole since 2003. And whilst there's work to do, our disability employment gap continues to fall as well. And so, Presiding Officer, as I do come to a close, our vision is clear, we understand the choices that need to be made, and we are absolutely determined to deliver economic growth that transforms lives, transforms communities and transforms this nation. And my final offer is to people across the chamber who share that vision and ambition, and to offer them the opportunity to be part of that, to work with me, and hope that we can deliver that shared objective for Scotland's people. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Could you please move the motion?
The motion.
Thank you very much. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move Amendment 136.79.2. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As the Deputy First Minister fairly said, she and I, and indeed Mr Johnson and others, have been doing the rounds, doing various debates in the course of the election campaign. Indeed, Mr Arthur, Mr Johnson and I were enjoying bacon rolls this morning, yet another hustings. So I feel this debate might be an extension of those particular engagements, although I hear the Deputy First Minister's strictures on not electioneering. Perhaps we will return to the question of the black hole at the heart of the SNP's manifesto on a different occasion, if we don't get the chance this afternoon. But can I start by welcoming the language in the government motion today? And indeed, I find very little in what the Deputy First Minister had to say in her speech that I could disagree with. I find it very encouraging. We have a government now talking positively about growing the economy. Now, of course, the Greens, the anti-growth Greens, are removed from government. They have more liberty to do that than they had previously. So that is a welcome change of direction from a government that now contains the Deputy First Minister. But, of course, language only takes us so far. What we actually have to see is action that matches words. And it's fair to say the track record of this government over the past few years has not been to put a focus on economic growth, but rather, I'm afraid, to put too many barriers in the way of growth. And this government has to start... yes, of course.
Deputy First Minister.
I just wonder who the member would reference as responsible for Scotland outperforming the rest of the UK economically in recent times.
Murdo Fraser.
Well, I think the Deputy First Minister has to look at the wider picture, because since 2014, the Scottish economy has grown on average at one half the rate of the UK economy. So we have a lot of catching up to do compared to even the sluggish growth we've seen in the UK economy, in line with all other Western economies hit by headwinds, including the fallout from the financial crash, the fallout from COVID, and, of course, the impact on the cost of living of Putin's invasion of Ukraine. So all economies have had these pressures, but she should not be too optimistic about the performance of the Scottish economy, taking the wider view. Now, talking about dismantling barriers, Fergus Ewing made an important intervention talking about planning, because that's a very good example. I remember when I met the Deputy First Minister's predecessor, Neil Gray, and we had a conversation when he took up his post, and he asked me what was the one thing he could do to help improve the performance of the economy. And I said, in line with Mr Ewing, to sort out planning. Yep. And the issue is not particularly the planning law or the planning rules, it is the administration of planning. It is the fact everything takes too long. And that is perhaps because we don't have enough planners. We're not training enough. We're not recruiting enough. I'll give away in a second. And that major barrier to progressing economic growth has to be addressed. I'll give away to Mr Ewing.
Fergus Ewing.
Would Murdo Fraser agree with me that there's merit and consideration so far as development of renewables is concerned in the UK, which both governments and all parties agree is a huge opportunity, that there should be set up a standing committee represented by and chaired by the UK government, but with devolved administrations, with the specific remit of ensuring that all public bodies that have a role to play, and there are a plethora of them, do their work on time. Otherwise, we risk losing opportunity and losing projects to many other competitors who are not hanging around as we seem to be.
Murdo Fraser.
Well, I think that Mr Ewing makes an important point. I don't like making off-the-cuff responses to ideas I've not heard before, but I think he identifies correctly that there is an issue, and we see that, for example, with the Berwick Bank renewable project, large wind farm, where, again, we're seeing substantial delays in terms of consenting. But it's not just in planning where we see issues around barriers. We've seen a whole host of new laws introduced by this government, all of them actively hampering the ability to grow the economy. So we've seen the introduction of the regulation of short-term lets, already leading to a loss of visitor accommodation, already leading to bed and breakfasts closing down across Scotland in large numbers, even though they were never part of the problem, but were caught up inadvertently, it seems, in these particular rules. We see the visitor levy being introduced, potentially taking millions of pounds from Scottish residents who want a holiday here and making Scottish tourism even less competitive than elsewhere. We've seen the ruinous deposit return scheme, hated by business, and now it seems subject to a £200 million litigation by BIFA. We see the rent cap and now the proposed introduction of rent controls, a policy which has already meant we've lost out on hundreds of millions of pounds of investment in the rental sector, a shortage in available properties and a spike in homelessness. Now, I would remind members of my register of interest in that I am the owner of a property let on a long-term basis, but many other landlords are selling up, creating shortages, all contributing to the housing emergency that this government accepts. And then we see, in a measure dear, I know, to the Deputy First Minister's own heart, the proposed ban on wood-burning stoves in new-build properties. So each and every one of these measures introduced by this government actively hampering economic growth. Now, our amendment today talks about taxation, because despite the protests from this government, they have extensive powers over taxation, complete control over non-domestic rates, control over non-savings, non-dividend income tax, and lands and buildings transaction tax. And we know they chose not to, pass on the 75% rates relief available to retail, hospitality and leisure businesses south of the border in the last year and in this year, putting businesses here at a competitive disadvantage. And we also know, and there's ample evidence this is the case, that the differential rates of income tax and LBTT are having an impact on economic growth. Writing in the Herald newspaper a couple of weeks ago, I'll give away in a second, the chief executive of the Glasgow Chamber of Commerce referred to the fact that businesses here are having to start to pay a Scotland weighting, a higher salary to take account of the fact that everybody over £28,000 pays higher tax in Scotland. And I've heard that from many other people in business. I'll give way to Keith Brown.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank Murdo Fraser for giving way? And I hear what he says. Would he want to congratulate, though, the Scottish Government on the fact that the majority of people in Scotland pay less in income tax than their UK counterparts? That even better, that is the majority drawn from the lowest paid in society. And also that across Scotland, we pay an average between £400 and £500 less in council tax every year. Is that not a good thing?
Murdo Fraser.
Well, the benefit for income tax is a few pennies a week. It makes no substantial difference to people's household incomes. Anybody above £28,000 is paying more. Anybody on incomes above £50,000 is paying substantially more. But let me give Mr. Brown an example, a real-life example of where this problem hits. Because when members of this Parliament's Economy and Fair Work Committee went to visit Prestwick Airport at the end of April, we were told by Ryanair, who have a substantial repair and maintenance facility at Prestwick Airport, that they are unable to attract qualified aircraft engineers to come to Scotland because of the tax differential. These are individuals paid £77,000, and they tell Ryanair they will not move to Scotland because of the income tax differential and the higher LBTT when it comes to purchasing a house. And that is an opportunity lost to Scotland, where Ryanair want to expand, but that is the reason they are giving why they cannot expand. Now, the HMRC figures recently show a loss of high earners, not necessarily people who are moving out of Scotland, but people perhaps deciding they're going to work fewer hours because it's no longer worth their while. And that applies in the public sector as much as the private sector. And it's no wonder so many organisations have criticised the widening tax differentials for undermining their ability to recruit and retain skilled staff. The Confederation of British Industry, the Scottish Retail Consortium, the British Dental Association, the Scottish Tourism Alliance, UK Hospitality Scotland, the Scottish Pub and Beer Association, the Scottish Licensed Trade Association, the Institute of Chartered Accountants in Scotland, the British Medical Association, all say it is making it more difficult for them to recruit and retain skilled or experienced professionals in their sectors. So, Presiding Officer, we want to see greater inward migration into Scotland to help grow our economy, but that ambition is being held back by the choices being made by this government.
No, the member is bringing his remarks to a close. Thank you.
My apologies. Presiding Officer, our ambition set out in our amendment today is to keep taxes in Scotland competitive with the rest of the UK so they create an incentive for individuals to move here to help address skills shortages and to help grow our economy. Our policy paper, Grasping the Thistle, which I commend to the Deputy First Minister, if she's not already read it, sets out a range of ideas on competitiveness, on skills, on regulation, on infrastructure, on innovation and entrepreneurship. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Government's change in rhetoric on the economy is very welcome, but it will only be meaningful if it is matched by action. This Government should start with addressing the tax differential. That is the point made in our amendment today, which I'm very pleased to move. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. I now call on Daniel Johnson to speak to and to move Amendment 136.79.3. Around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. And let me start by approaching this debate, I think, very much in the spirit I think that it's being offered by the government. And I think the economy is too important, in a sense, to discuss it only through the, kind of the narrow frame of partisan jibes, discussion and disagreement. And actually, I think there are broad areas where there probably is disagreement, and frankly, broad areas which are just very complicated and require the kind of open approach, pragmatic discussion and actually examination of the different ideas in order that we can actually secure the future that we want for everyone. But can I say that I very much welcome the government using the word growth? And that's where I'd like to begin my remarks, because it is really important. And I think growth is important for three key reasons. First of all, from the Labour benches, that we believe that the best way of eradicating poverty is by increasing access to well-paid jobs, high productive, high wage jobs. And that is only possible if you have growth. Growth for growth's sake is not very useful. Now, I know Ross Grey isn't in the chamber, but we were just doing Politics Scotland earlier on, and he was saying GDP is too crude a measure, and I agree. But GDP per head is fundamentally important. That's a measure I will return to. But secondly, demographic change. If we are going to organise our economy with a working age population smaller than the post-working age population, we need growth. We need more people doing more productive jobs, and that will not be easy. And finally, if we are going to realise our net zero potential, if we are going to have a 21st century energy economy based on renewables, we need growth. We fundamentally need investment. We need our energy to be more efficiently produced, and that will only be delivered if we achieve growth. I'm happy to give way to Fergus Ewing.
Fergus Ewing.
I must say I do agree with the principles of what Mr Johnson has said. To achieve that growth in renewables, does he agree with me that it's essential that we continue to support our oil and gas sector because they have the investment that we need from the private sector and they have the skills that we must retain if we're to develop the supply chain and achieve the success and if we are to maintain investor confidence to raise the £1.4 trillion that's required to invest in renewables, only a small fraction of which the government can afford?
Daniel Johnson.
Well, look, I agree with the broad sentiment. I suspect there may be some points of disagreement implied, but let me acknowledge this, that, look, two things. First of all, transition is a necessity. We have 10% of the extractable resource left in the ground. So whatever we do, we need to transition. And critically, if we're going to realise some of our strategic potential in terms of floating offshore, carbon capture and storage, the expertise, the engineering required to do that is going to come from the oil and gas sector. Those are the people that know how to do that stuff. And where I absolutely agree is that we cannot have a cliff edge. We need those jobs, we need those skills, we need those assets. And so that transition has to be a partnership between government and those people that have that expertise. But I'd just like to make some progress. But look, I think critically, that is why growth matters. And I would bring back to that point around eradicating poverty and improving equality. And I know my colleagues, both Alec Rowley and Faisal Chowdhury, will continue on those points about how we expand opportunity and how growth should be used to expand opportunities for all. Now, in terms of our amendment this afternoon, I think what is important, if we're going to realise those opportunities, we need to understand our headwinds. What are both the risks and the threats that we have? And I fear sometimes when the government approaches these topics, they want to circumscribe. We've already had a little bit of that. The government is very, very keen to highlight figures or metrics that show where they have succeeded, but fairly unwilling to look at either the broader context or those metrics which point in the opposite direction. And this is why I come back to GDP per head, because the simple fact is this. In the first decade of this new millennium, the gap in GDP per head between the UK and Scotland shrank. It shrank from about a 10% gap to about a 5% gap. But in the subsequent decade, it has increased. Now, I think whatever other metrics one wants to choose, that is the fundamental one that we have to focus on, because that is actually a loss of opportunity, a loss of earning potential for people. So let's start with that one. But we also need to recognise that it's a lack of investment that is holding this country back. And again, the headline figures often obscure this, but up until the previous quarter, we had seven quarters of decline in that self-same metric across the UK. The reason for that is poor levels of investment. But we also need to look at things like entrepreneurial activity. Again, Scotland lacks in terms of entrepreneurial activity and company creation. And most critically, we have unequal growth. The reality is the vast bulk of growth in Scotland is generated from Scotland's own southeast. The output per hour worked in Edinburgh and the Lothians is some 50% higher than it is in other parts of Scotland, such as the West or in around Tayside. So why is that? And I would suggest that we need to look at those issues. What are the structural barriers? Where are the regional economic development? Why strategies that should enable people to link up between the opportunities that exist in other parts of Scotland with their potential, their skills, their talents in the places that they live. Now, how much more time do I have, Deputy President Officer?
I can be relatively generous.
Relatively? Yeah. I'll understand
that. Up to seven minutes.
That's very kind, Deputy Presiding Officer. I don't know what I've done to deserve that, but I'll take it. But critically, what we need to do is have much greater focus and clarity. That's why we set out in our document, Building a Business Case for Scotland, three key focuses around Brand Scotland, Net Zero, Technology and Financial Services. And I note the Deputy First Minister might have highlighted the same three focuses in a recent column that she wrote for the, I think it was the Herald newspaper. So I'm very grateful and flattered by that compliment. But I think we also need to focus on the how. Because it's not just, I think, enough to have those focuses. I share many of our ambitions, but what needs to change? What are the things in our enterprise agencies, our policy approaches, which are holding those things back? So I think we need greater clarity across our enterprise agencies. We often talk about a cluttered landscape. That's not just about necessarily reducing the number, but I think making sure that they have clear function and focus and that they're working together. I think we need a much better focus on actually how wider policies impact on these things. We've already talked about planning, but what are other points of regulation and points of contact between the private sector and government are impeding things? And we need much better ability to do regional economic delivery. And I think that goes much far beyond what regional economic partnerships seek to deliver. We need genuine regional approach to government. And I think my 7 minutes is up. But critically, this is about how we improve the life chances of people across Scotland. That's why growth matters. It's about tackling poverty, tackling inequality, increasing people's life chances. And I'll close there. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I now call Maggie Chapman to speak to Move Amendment 13679.1. A similarly generous 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to open on behalf of the Scottish Greens this afternoon, and I move the amendment in my name. There are, I believe, two fundamental questions raised by the title of this afternoon's debate. What do we mean by the economy, and what is it that we want to grow? Historically, and still for many politicians and economists today, the answer to the first question is extractivism, an economy based on colonial exploitation of people and resources, especially fossil fuels. And the answer to the second has been GDP. These answers, taken together with the age-old notion that wealth will inevitably, eventually, trickle down, we have the current economic model. But these answers never made very much sense. I want to make some progress, please. These answers never made very much sense except to perpetuate a status quo that cushioned the already more than comfortable. And now, in a time of climate chaos and obscene inequality, they make no sense at all. If our economy does not address these emergencies, the climate crisis and inequality, it is at best pointless in practice, simply enabling and exacerbating them. As the government motion recognises, we are in a different world now, and we urgently need... Yes, I'll take...
Good mate.
Thank the presiding officer... Sorry, the member for giving way. The member just said that it would be bonkers not to do a list of things. Surely it would be bonkers not to make sure that people had jobs so they could tackle things like the deficiencies they have and also tackle the climate emergency. Without the money, that they can do nothing.
Maggie Chapman, I'll give you the time back.
Presiding officer, I did not use those words. What I said, and if you listened carefully, Mr Mountain, I said, if our economy does not address the climate crisis or the inequality crisis that we have, what is the point of it? What is it there to do? As the government motion recognises, we are in a different world now, and we urgently need to make a just and sustainable transition to an economy which meets its challenges and to forms of growth which recognise its realities. That means fundamental changes of approach, trajectory and objective, not simply substituting renewables for hydrocarbons, for example. We need to look at different answers, the answers that I and other green activists have been talking about for years. Central to this thinking is the concept of a well-being economy, one that meets the real and urgent needs of workers and communities, that respects the natural world and those who protect it, and that continues to flourish safely alongside future generations. And I'll take an intervention.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Member, for
for giving way. She made an important point about some of the flaws in GDP calculations. One example that she might agree with me on is that new build housing construction is factored into new GDP figures, but renovations and retrofits aren't. Isn't that a perverse situation in a climate emergency with massive amounts of housing that's needing badly to be refurbished?
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think there are many perverse realities in our current economy, and such as the one you highlight. And I know my colleague Lorna Slater will speak later in this debate about how the vision that we want to present can be made real and tangible to deal with some of those perversities and create the kind of industrial strategy that Scotland so desperately needs. For our answer to the second question is key. What is it that we want to grow? Not the sterile statistic of GDP, but our capacity to thrive as a nation, as cities, as towns and villages, as families, as communities, as unique and inspiring human beings. Yes, under the current devolution settlement, our resources are limited indeed, our agency significantly challenged. That is why, as Greens, we argue for an independent Scotland, one with the powers and capacities to act as radically, as swiftly, and as compassionately as the intersecting crises require. But we cannot let these resource and agency limitations distract us from the work we can do today. If we advocate for independence for a very different kind of state, it is more important than ever to pay attention to what we are doing now, to exactly what kind of future we are investing in. Does it plant seeds of care and creativity, as well as science and technology? Does it support cooperatives and social enterprises, as well as ambitious entrepreneurs? Does it measure success by equality and well-being, as well as productivity and export? The current model does not do these things. The purpose of modern state capitalism is to socialise the costs and risks of the society and economy while privatising the profits. This does not plant those seeds of care and creativity or generate and sustain equality and well-being. So this is where this debate crucially connects with one of the debates I spoke in last week on our shared priority to eradicate child poverty. For it is by looking at our economy through that clear and focused lens, by asking what impact each of our decisions about investment, about policy or practice has upon the poorest children and the adults they will become, by making their rights real and realised, it is by doing these things that we will find the direction for the economy we need. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Michelle Thompson to be followed by Edward Mountain, around 4 minutes. Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to support this motion. Scotland is our business, Scotland is open for business, and the SNP is focused on supporting and growing that business. It is a pity about the lack of a realistic plan from either the Tory or Labour benches to enhance our prospects for growth. The Tories have lost the plot, but Labour's rollback in their Green Prosperity Plan, combined with adopting the Tories' fiscal rules, will be hugely damaging. Not my words, but that of the IFS. Here's what they said about Labour's plans for green investment, and I quote, "After paring back the plan substantially, the proposed additional spending would amount to less than half of the additional investment spending the OBR thought would be required to be consistent with the recommendations of the Climate Change Committee in 2021. Yes, I will.
Smith.
Well, for giving way, would you like to comment on what David Phillips said from the Institute of Fiscal Studies at the manifesto launch for the SNP today about the extent of the big black hole?
Michelle Thompson.
Liz Smith knows that we've had many discussions about this, and I would highlight back to her the Scottish Fiscal Commission report in terms of fiscal sustainability, the fact that 18% of Scotland's capital budget is required for us to get to net zero. And I would levy back to her, why isn't she clamouring in the light of that for increased fiscal powers for the Scottish Government? Accumulation of capital stock and increasing the supply of a well-educated workforce are also of vital importance for growth. But today I want to focus on the most important factor of long-term growth, that of technological innovation. And there are lessons to be learned from history. The first industrial revolution in the 18th century, we saw steam power really taking off with the innovations of James Watt. The second industrial revolution, the rate of technological change accelerated again, leading to electricity enabling new technologies. The arrival of transistors in the mid-20th century laid the foundations of the third industrial revolution, marking the beginning of the digital era with opportunities enabled by the Internet of Things, cloud and big data. So who on earth then, when we consider the growth enabled by technology, thought it a good idea to remove the UK from the EU digital single market? Prior to Brexit, the UK digital economy growth rate averaged 24.1% annually, but by June 2022 had fallen to 0.7%. According to research from Professor Alison Hammond. Yet the Tories and Labour parties are now Brexiteers, with the Lib Dems wringing their hands after rolling back their previous opposition. The power of technology to drive change is spurred by their growth and use. The United Workforce Network argued in 2020 there are currently over 19,000 million devices connected to the internet, over 5,000 million mobile users, and about 2 zettabytes of traffic per year at global level. This is the era of big data. So I was delighted last year the Scottish Government launched its 10-year innovation strategy, calling for Scotland to drive towards ranking alongside Denmark, Norway and Finland in being recognised as one of the most innovative medium-sized countries in the world. The challenge we all face is neatly summed up in MarTech's law. This states that unlike information technologies, which grow exponentially, organisations grow logarithmically. It follows that if organisations don't adapt to the pace of change, extinction will be inevitable. And this process is what some people call digital Darwinism. If we don't get on board, if organisations in both the public and private sectors fail to keep up and be much better attuned to continuous innovation, they will become part of digital Darwinism, where organisational extinction is just as much on the agenda as organisational progress. And this is a major challenge we face as we rightly pursue economic growth. Scotland's up for that challenge, and I look forward to seeing the continued focus on economic growth outlined in the motion today. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to advise the Chamber, the time in hand that we had has now pretty much been exhausted, so members will have to stick to their speaking time allocations. With that, I call Edward Mountain to be followed by John Mason. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And before I go into my speech, I just want to remind members that I, as declared in my register of interest, I do run 2 small businesses. And it is this afternoon that I want to speak about small businesses and the vital role that they play in the growth of Scotland's economy. Let's say consider a small business in the Highlands that employs 6 people, each on a salary of £30,000 per year. It's impossible, however hard you try, to eventually measure how that money is spread. But inevitably, employees will spend their wages in local shops, cafes, restaurants, entertainment facilities, or on local services. They'll keep the transport going. They'll keep the workers driving the buses if they can find them and the trains working, and they'll be ensuring local connectivity. They'll contribute to the local charities and the non-profit organisations, perhaps by giving freely of their time, and they'll support a myriad of other businesses. As well as this reinvestment in the local economy, some of those 6 employees may have children in primary or secondary schools, thus helping the communities employ teachers, childcare providers and support staff, in turn ensuring that local children continue to access good local education. So don't close our schools. They will contribute to the employment of doctors and GPs and dentists and nurses and pharmacists. So keep the local GPs open, keep the pharmacies open and also keep local hospitals open. In essence, those small businesses are providing, and their 6 employees, are creating many more jobs than we could even calculate in the local economy. It functions rather like a cog in a much greater network, which certainly employs dozens, if not hundreds, of jobs across Scotland. If this Scottish Government overlooks or neglects small businesses and neglects local services, there will be collateral implications for the foreseeable future. There is nothing small about the impact of these small businesses across Scotland. In 2020, a staggering 87% of the 180,000 businesses registered in Scotland were defined as micro-enterprises, companies that employ 9 people. And the government's own 2020 Rural Enterprise Support Evaluation stresses that nearly 3 times as many people in remote rural areas work for small businesses compared to those in the rest of Scotland. That means that when small businesses are left unsupported or local services are cut, meaning that they can't find employees, then the economies of rural and island communities are hit the hardest. Indeed, parts of the Highlands and Islands that have local economies are made up purely of these small businesses. Yes, small businesses function as a close-knit community, which inevitably look after one another and attempt to self-sustain. But they require help, Cabinet Secretary. The Federation of Small Businesses in Scotland chair recently commented that the First Minister needs to put growth and the needs of small businesses at the heart of his agenda. The very last thing that employees in these small businesses need are tax increases. It restricts the amount of money that they can spend locally, and they know how to spend it well. If we do not look after the small businesses and their employees and reinvest in local economies and keeping local services open during this time, we are going to consign Scotland's rural communities, to the further depopulation that we're seeing across the Highlands. And that's bad news. We cannot afford to let the Highlands and Islands wither and die by not investing in the very small businesses that keep Scotland going. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call John Mason to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Up to four minutes, Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to take part today. Firstly, I would say that I wholeheartedly support growing the economy. We want to see our society as a whole becoming better off, so that quality and well-paid jobs are available to all of our citizens, and everyone benefits from an improved standard of living. However, we face a number of challenges in growing the economy, including having a fairly static population. It is incredibly difficult to grow an economy if the population is not growing. That is exacerbated, as is the case for many countries, by having an ageing population, meaning fewer people available to work. So we need to address this in the longer term by encouraging families to have more children, and in the shorter term by allowing more people to migrate here to work. But this latter in turn has been made more difficult because of the UK's overly harsh immigration policy. So the Conservative amendment today is incredibly ironic, as they call for more people to come and work here while they themselves stop that happening. By contrast, Australia has a regional visa system. Very briefly, yes.
Briefly, Murdoch.
Wait, for giving way. How can you describe a policy as harsh when the levels of net migration into the United Kingdom are now at record levels?
Mason.
Well, I think my point, if Mr Fraser would like to listen to just the next paragraph, is that we need targeted immigration. By contrast, Australia has a regional visa system to promote economic growth outside the major metropolitan areas. People have to live, work and study in a designated regional area, and such a system could hugely benefit the economy here in Scotland. So we face barriers to growing the economy, several of which are out with our control. Now, some have suggested even today that increased income tax might also be a barrier to people coming to Scotland. But we have heard at the Finance Committee that in most age groups, people are coming to Scotland from the rest of the UK than are leaving. And this will be a mystery to some Conservatives, because they think that more money is the key to everything and that everyone else will make decisions based purely on self-centred financial motives. So I would just want to let the Conservatives into a little secret. Not everyone lives lives purely dominated by personal financial gain. Some people want to come and live in Scotland because we have such a good environment, with cleaner rivers, lochs and seas. Others because the NHS is better and there are shorter waiting times. Just recently, a constituent told me she had moved from Kent, where she could not get an NHS dentist at all. But she came to Glasgow and immediately got an NHS dentist. Others come for our world-class universities and research sector. Some want to live in a fairer society, even if they do pay a bit more tax. Another factor in all this is where the benefits of economic growth are going to. If growth means foreign-owned multinationals making increased profits, then that sounds to me like bad growth. By contrast, if it is social enterprises, cooperatives or employee-owned businesses which are growing and the jobs and the profits are likely to stay in Scotland, that is good. But that does in turn take us to the subject of scaling up and why Scottish businesses are often sold by the founders before they have really grown to a significant size. It is not that we want to be overly protective of Scottish ownership, but it does seem that businesses in a number of other countries are not sold off as readily as they are here. Commonweal estimate that in 2021, £36.5 billion was extracted from Scotland, mainly as profits and dividends, while only £26.4 billion flowed in, a net outward flow of £10.1 billion. Now, I am not saying that I am opposed to foreign direct investment, and many of the jobs linked to FDI are good jobs and well paid. But I just point out that there is a downside to having so many of our businesses foreign-owned. Scottish Financial Enterprise have produced a brief manifesto for the next UK government. Some points I've already mentioned, like looking at the immigration system and student visas to attract the talent here. But they do emphasise that the UK government should work more with the Scottish government. And I would just finish on that point, that in recent years the UK government has seemed to want to give Scotland a kicking, and that has to stop. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Claire Adamson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Growing the economy must be number one priority of government in Scotland and Westminster. Over the last 17 years, both Scotland and the United Kingdom have been sluggish in economic growth. The National Institute of Economic and Social Research estimates that since the 2008 financial crisis, the UK economy has grown by an average of 1.2% each year, down from an average of 2.3% in decades prior. In Scotland, we lag behind the rest of the UK in GDP growth, with 2025 forecast to remain the same. Make no mistake, economic growth is stagnating, and the working people of Scotland are paying the price of 2 weak governments. Research from the University of Strathclyde shows that early entrepreneurial activity in Scotland is lower than the UK average. To grow a strong economy and build our reputation as a great place to do business, early entrepreneurs must be better supported. In particular, our technology sector, which is suffering from a lack of capital investment, would benefit. Scottish Government grants need to grow businesses in the long term and reward entrepreneurship. Edinburgh has a growing technology sector, and we cannot afford to miss out. It is imperative the government works with our tech and digital industries so we can be best placed to take advantage of new technologies like AI. Growth is also being stunted by our skill system. The Chamber of Commerce Business Barometers found 71% of organisations in Scotland were facing skill shortages. And the Scottish Government has allowed this to happen by not planning for the sector key to Scotland's success and failing to provide workers with the right skills. Our skill system is rigid and doesn't adapt to the needs of businesses and people which slows growth. But while economic inactivity is rising to 23.2%, the Scottish Government has cut the budget for skills programmes, which supports young people into work by 36%. Scottish Labour will work in partnership with businesses to create a flexible, modular skill system underpinned by digital skills passport, which can adapt to the needs of the economy. And UK Labour would set up a national wealth fund, unlocking private investment and creating 69,000 green jobs. To conclude, Presiding Officer, The Scottish Government's focus on economic growth now is welcome, but their record does not reflect these warm words. We are lagging in productivity and employment compared to the rest of the UK. Scotland needs a government which will put growth first and work with businesses to invest and unlock Scotland's potential. And Scottish Labour is ready for a change. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Alec Rowley. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I had expected to be speaking a lot about technology today. I'm sure that's no surprise to anyone in the Chamber. But I have to say I'm very delighted in the contributions from particularly Michelle Thompson and also the Cabinet Secretary herself about how important technology and the Fourth Industrial Revolution is to how we grow Scotland going forward. But there's a couple of reflections I'd like to make about oil and gas. Particularly in quite rightly, Mr Ewing talking about how we need to be using the technology and using the advantages in the North East. And I absolutely agree that when we talk about moving towards net zero, it does not mean that we're abandoning the North East or the oil companies or that technology. Indeed, Fervo Energy in Texas since 2003 has been adapting oil and gas infrastructure and drilling infrastructure to convert to geothermal energy. And that's the way forward, and that's how we make sure that no one is left behind as we move towards net zero. But as Maggie Chapman has said, it's absolutely imperative that we make those provisions going forward. But I do want to talk a little bit about the technology experience that I have had. The Fourth Industrial Revolution is upon us, and I've chaired and attended many meetings in the last year focused on science and tech, and there are common threads. Principally, we need a sustained investment and focus on innovation in these sectors. But I also want to say that we have to encourage our young people into STEM careers. I'm very lucky to have New College Lanarkshire, Motherwell Campus in my area, which has the Smart Hub, which looks at working with local small businesses in particular. And with those small businesses, they're looking at using fourth-generation, fifth-generation robots, and that's in food production, in manufacturing, in warehousing, in packaging, and welding and repair, including in the in-situ repairing of turbines in our renewable sector. And all of these show that all work is moving towards the use of robots, the use of AI and the use of technology, and we have to adapt and we have to embrace that opportunity for Scotland. We don't often recognise the great work that is happening, and the cross-party group in science and technology was given a whistle-top tour of the pioneering research in quantum tech and semiconductors, and it was mentioned by the Cabinet Secretary. I was so delighted to see this, because this will be transformational and it will be a step change again in how we can use AI and the Internet of Things to look after our environment, our healthcare, our communications, and in monitoring systems. And I think it's really exciting to see that coming forward. We do have expertise in hydrogen, which I don't think has been mentioned so far. But I also want to talk about the Scottish games sector. And this is something that's really important to Scotland going forward. And we see it as part of our cultural economy, but it's really important. But we could be doing more in this area. Indeed, we're talking about the economic inward investment. We see that in Dundee in our games sector, but we need more of that because it generates over 2.4 billion for the Finnish economy, and Scotland could be taking more advantage of that. So I'd like to see some more work in that. But I do want to say to Mr Mountain, when he was talking about his employees, I'm sure they'll also be delighted when they come to work for him and in the Highlands that they get free prescriptions, free bus passes, 11-40 hours, child care, child payment advantages, care payments. They'll be included in the Scottish Fair Work agenda, and they also get free further and higher education for their children, which will be of advantage. And I shall finish there, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by George Adam. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the brief time I have, I want to talk about education skills and the failure of joined-up government, which I believe sits at the heart of many of the problems that we have in Scotland at the current time. I've always believed that Scotland's greatest asset is its people. And if you want to have a successful economy, a growing economy and a productive economy, then you need to have a highly educated and highly skilled population. The last few years, I have met many employers up and down Scotland, and you're guaranteed that when you ask them what are the issues, that education and skills will always come up. If you look at Rosyth Dockyard across M5, many of the people I talk to there describe Rosyth Dockyard as the United Nations, because the reality is that they could not survive and deliver on the contracts that they have if they were not actively seeking skilled labour from abroad, and they are just unable to, like so many employers in Scotland, get the skills and the skilled labour in this country. So the SNP have been in power for 17 years. Education and skills are devolved, and there is no excuse for not getting it right. I looked this morning at the EIS Stand Up for Quality Education manifesto for this election. Firstly, it says, build the resources and school culture to address distressed, violent and aggressive pupil behaviour. Now, this is a major issue. Last year, the government held three emergency summits to discuss how we address these issues. And it seems to me, for the level of emails I'm getting from parents and teachers, that we're actually not much further forward in terms of fixing that specific issue in our schools. I've highlighted three areas: pupil behaviour, violent and aggressive behaviour being part of it, secure an increase in funding and support for pupils with additional support needs. Again, it is not rocket science. There is a complete failure to recognise the need to invest in our schools and get additional support teachers into our classrooms. And thirdly, achieve a significant reduction in teacher workload. You only need to meet teachers, talk to teachers, to know that there are real issues there. The fourth that I would add is the SNP manifesto commitment they brought forward in 2007 was to cut class sizes. Again, total failure to actually achieve that. Then I would go on in terms of education and move from the schools, which I say have major issues that are just not being tackled by this SNP government, and I would move on to colleges. And if we are going to have a successful economy, then I think everybody in this chamber would acknowledge we have to have investment in colleges, and we need to fix the massive problems that are in our colleges. We have a minister for colleges that seems to be posted missing when it comes to addressing the actual issues that we have. Industrial relations are at an all-time low. We're having strike after strike after strike. The students are being let down, and morale within our colleges is at rock bottom. And yet we have a government minister that says, now to do with me, mate. This is for somebody else to deal with. Again, we have seen over many years the SNP make structural changes within colleges, but continue to fail. So education and skills are key to a successful economy. The SNP government must address the issues we have, otherwise we will not have a successful economy moving forward.
Thank you, Mr Rowley. We now move to the final speaker in the open debate, George Adam. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I've listened to colleagues during this debate, and as much I agree with many of them, not all of them, but hey, in this new consensual world, let's not look for too many miracles at the one time. But it'll come as no surprise to anyone that I agree with the premise that the Scottish Government is delivering a strong and resilient economy for Scotland. And as others have said, Scotland is outperforming other parts of the United Kingdom. But not only that, Scotland is currently the top destination for foreign investment outside of London in Europe. And in 2023, earnings in Scotland grew faster than any other part of the UK, including London and the South East. But let's get to the important part of my speech, Presiding Officer, and let's talk about positive Paisley, because it's been a while since I've had the chance to do that. But there have been some key Scottish Government investments in my constituency over recent years, and Paisley High Street has the same challenges that high streets have across the whole country. And I've listened to the debate, I think it was Edward Mountain talking about small businesses and investment and how you can actually get them to work together. And the challenge that Renfrewshire Council has is they've actually had two buildings bookending the High Street, one being the historic town hall on one side and the other side having the Paisley Museum and also the library. And what they've done is they've managed to get the investment through various other various ways of £100 million investment in the town centre, but through National Lottery Heritage Funding, the Scottish Government Regeneration Capital Grant Fund, as well as a number of other trust foundations and private donors. But the museum itself is the biggest cultural project currently in construction in Scotland, and it's a £45 million investment. Now, basically, it's going to generate around 125,000 visitors a year. So that's 125,000 people walking up and down the length of Paisley High Street. There's 138 jobs being supported during the construction and 48 jobs per year through revenue and visitor spending in the future. And new footfall, obviously, for the town centre and the High Street itself. But as I said, this is part of a £100 million investment, presiding officer, which includes a Paisley Learning Cultural Hub that replaces Paisley Central Library and occupies what was once a retail space in the High Street. And that was an investment of £7 million. It's housed in a former High Street shop and spread over four stories. And the new building includes a reception area, children's library and storytelling area with a new unique play structure, including a climbing wall and slide also in place, having been co-designed with renowned Scottish artist Claire Bartley. The upper floors have an outdoor terrace and community rooms. And this is the type of thinking we need to increase footfall in our high streets, bring increased economic value to our towns. But it doesn't stop there, presiding officer. If that wasn't just good enough for the good people of Paisley, it gets even better with the SNP administration in Renfrewshire. There is also a £20 million regeneration of Paisley Town Hall, I've mentioned, which has now created, transformed the historic town hall into one of the country's leading entertainment values, again moving into the nighttime economy and generating kind of business for the businesses in the local area as well. And last year, Paisley Town Hall was reopened. The Deputy First Minister will be pleased to hear this, in all its glory when it held the Royal National Mod. And that had that event brought 8,410 visitors to Paisley alone, which was an increase of the same event in Perth of 12% last year. Presiding officer, when you look at this in closing, I would like to say, you know, we can look at the investment that's been made. That's been made by the Council, the Scottish Government, over a few years. But we're living in a time where Westminster is cutting these budgets. It's stopping us from being able to make these investments and make towns like Paisley move forward. For me, and it always has been, and no one will be surprised, that I believe we have the full levers of powers and get the economic powers we need so that we can do what's happened in Paisley and towns and cities across the whole of Scotland and ensure that we can build that future that we want for our town centres.
Thank you very much, Mr Adam. We move to closing speeches. I'm disappointed to note that one of the members that participated in the debate is not here for closing speeches. I will expect an explanation and indeed an apology. And I call First Lorna Slater up to 4 minutes. Ms Slater.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have listened with interest to the debate today, and I hear how heavily members across this chamber are leaning on what Andy Haldane of the Financial Times referred to as the growth fairy to resolve all of our economic problems. Because as Mr. Haldane goes on to say, absent the growth fairy, the other options are considerably more painful. There is a conspiracy of silence about what those other options look like. Spoiler, they look like talking honestly about taxation. Who pays what and how much? Again, I am indebted to Mr. Haldane for this quote. Political parties project a fall in public investment as a share of GDP over the next parliament, from a base several percentage points below the UK's competitors. We can hope that private investment fills the gap, but hope is not a growth strategy. And private investors might be cautious about rushing in where public investment fears to tread. We do need all governments in the UK to recognise public investment is needed to give confidence to private investment. But what about taking a different approach to our economy? What about, instead of waiting for the growth fairy to sprinkle us with her bounty, which we can then presumably allow to trickle down to workers and communities, what about instead of that, we build our new economy for the post-fossil-free world from the bottom up? We don't treat paying living wages as optional. We don't consider removing or restricting benefits needed for the basic necessities of life under any circumstances. And we don't consider nature and the environment to be acceptable collateral damage. We need to ensure that everyone in society benefits when the economy is doing well. This means ensuring that more people have a stake in it. Community ownership, support for social enterprises, cooperatives, and other alternative business models give people that stake and ensures that people are at the heart of the economy rather than profit. We must ensure that women are equally participating in this new economy. Getting 50% women in all training, education, and employment opportunities should be the goal, and we should be setting quotas to support this. Scotland has so much potential for a thriving economy in a post-fossil-free world. We've got the infrastructure, even if it's a bit crumbly now, and history in heavy engineering. From the port of Dundee to the harbour in Aberdeen and all the way up to Nigg, we are already designing and building the future. Wind turbines, tidal turbines, energy storage systems, and equipment for green hydrogen generation and distribution. We have the potential for a major reindustrialisation of Scotland. And we can shape a vision for leading the way on designing, building, installing, and maintaining the machines that will generate and store the clean energy of the future. But this means making a clear change of direction away from oil and gas, and committing to and investing in these new industries. Oil and gas production in the North Sea is in decline and must continue to decline. We have this moment of hope to seize the opportunity to focus on the new economy. If we fail to do so, if we cling to dying industries, other countries will pull ahead. And they will build the wind turbines, the electric and hydrogen-powered vehicles. They will install the hydrogen infrastructure, the cranes, the ports, the quays. And this moment of opportunity will be lost for Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Daniel Johnson up to 6 minutes. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. In summing up, I'm going to seek to be deliberately contrarian and both agree and disagree with people in the same instance. And let me start with both Lorna Slater and Maggie Chapman, because I agree with them in one very fundamental sense. Growth for growth's sake is no use at all. If all we're talking about is growing raw GDP, then frankly we're not delivering anything at all. But what I would say is that we do need growth for the very reasons that they set out. We need growth because we need to drive investment in green infrastructure. We need growth because we have an ageing economy. And frankly, the only way we'll deal with that is if we invest in our people and invest in their ability to do the jobs that they seek to do. That requires growth, and it needs a very hard-nosed approach to it. And this is why GDP per head is the real measure, coupled with an absolute laser-like focus on the Gini coefficient. Those two things hand in hand. And does that capture everything? No. But they're the best measures we have of making sure that we're increasing prosperity and reducing inequality as we do it. Because I think fundamentally that's where we do agree. That what we must be about is ensuring that, as Maggie Chapman said, we enhance people's ability to thrive. That is the fundamental reason, and that's why it's important. It's why I actually slightly disagree with John Mason. That where he's right, that it's difficult to grow an economy unless you have migration, actually, ultimately, if you're not careful, you are masking that fundamental truth about GDP per head. But he is right that is difficult to achieve. I'd also like to agree and disagree with the Deputy First Minister, because I think she is absolutely right in terms of her focus on technology and startups. But I think we need to be careful that we don't view that as being the only focus or the only route to supporting entrepreneurial activity. So I'm very supportive of the scale-up initiatives. And indeed, I think one of the things that is most useful from the Logan Review is the concept of pipeline. I think what I would like to see, though, is that is applied more broadly. Because absolutely, we do need those startups. We need those innovative companies. But I would also say, actually, we need the application of that technology and that investment in the small businesses that Edward Mountain was highlighting. Because the reality is it's not actually that those companies are more inherently productive, it's just that they have access to more investment. It's investment that drives productivity, and actually the real problem in this country, and it's a stubborn problem, is that smaller businesses struggle to find the finance, struggle to find the investment, and therefore don't take up the opportunities of technology, don't take up the opportunities of improving the productivity of their people. And actually I very much agree with Claire Adamson, because there are huge possibilities both with AI, with robotics. But I think unless we focus on that, we will continue to see both large companies and also the companies engaged in that startup culture benefiting, but actually we will leave other companies of other sizes and scale behind. Very happy to give way.
Deputy First Minister.
I completely agree with the member, and my first role back in 2018 was very much digital boost focused, if you recall, trying to get more traditional businesses embracing technology. And so the point I would put to him, where he hopefully will agree, is that we have a productivity challenge, and that productivity challenge will be in part answered by the private investment in processes and skills, technology and people hand in hand.
Daniel Johnson.
Look, I'd completely agree with that. And actually, you know, the thing that the event we were at this morning alluded to by Murdo Fraser, I was making the point that all the changes we need to see across our economy, across our society, will only be delivered if they're done in partnership between the state and the private sector. So I think absolutely it requires private sector investment. But what I would say is I think there is a role there to help shape that, potentially also, even if it's not direct investment, looking at de-risking investment, because very often these small firms struggle to raise the investment, and that's the fundamental driver. And it's like if you treat productivity as magic fairy dust, as been described earlier on, you'll never deliver it. But it is about investment. It's about investment in plant, machinery, equipment, the things that enable people to do their jobs. I'm slightly struggling for time. I'm afraid I think I'd like to make a little bit of progress. Can I just alight on a point that George Adam was making? And I know he's sort of somewhat staggered by the consensual point, but let me make one. I think he's right to highlight the role of his local area, the role of Paisley, because actually ultimately this is the other mistake I think we make in Scotland in particular. We have a very top-down approach to the economy, but the economies are built bottom-up. And actually, if you look at the successful areas across the United Kingdom who are building investment, I think it's the metro regions. If you look at what Manchester is doing, it's been a metropolitan-led investment. And I think we need to look at the powers that area has been granted. So, for example, they are baselining business rates, and the upside of those business rates are accruing to the Greater Manchester Authority, which means that they are aligning their policies to the growth of that area. And indeed, as Murdo Fraser was pointing out in private earlier on, we have the same framework. We could do the same thing here. And just finally, in closing, I just want to conclude by highlighting the remarks of both Alec Rowley and Faisal Chowdhury, because ultimately, the economy is built around people. And unless we get our education system right, our skills system right, unless we have a system that enables people to upskill and reskill as our economy changes, enable people to take up the opportunities, we will leave things behind. And just one final point is this, is that United Nations at recite...
No, he's about to conclude.
Moment, is that's a tragedy, because many people in Fife and up and down the East Coast struggle to find good work and good wages. And it's right there for them. And it's for the want of the right the schemes, the right opportunities, the right training.
Need to conclude, Mr. Johnson.
And that's for the issue we need to tackle.
Thank you. And I call Liz Smith up to 7 minutes, please, Ms. Smith.
Thank you. I think this has been a very interesting and generally very positive debate. I say that from an angle that I want to pick up something that Michelle Thompson said in her speech, some speech that I don't entirely agree with, obviously, because she's still not answering my question about how she would fill the big black hole in SNP finances. But nonetheless, Michelle Thompson referenced the Scottish Fiscal Commission's 2023 sustainability report. And I think it's a pity, Cabinet Secretary, that and the Finance Committee members are unanimous in this, that we've not actually been able to have a debate on that specific issue, because that was promised by the Scottish Government back several months ago. And I think the backdrop to all the things that we've been discussing today would have been very helpful if we'd had that debate as well, because that report is actually seminal in the way forward when it comes to economic growth. Now, the Deputy First Minister was very clear when she was a backbencher and also at a recent meeting of the Economy and Fair Work Committee that the priority for the Scottish Government is to remove the barriers which hamper business expansion and do much more to encourage the private sector to play a leading role in the pursuit of economic growth. That, I have to say, is one of the most encouraging remarks that I've heard from the Scottish Government over a long period of time, and I'm sure that the Cabinet Secretary, Deputy First Minister, will hold to that, because that is essential if we are going to ensure that Scotland does have economic growth. And she was also very clear at the time, and I quote, that the best way to grow the economy is to attract people to come and work here. And she offered the view, rightly so, in my opinion, that the SNP cannot go on increasing tax rates, as has been the case for the last few years, without some detrimental effects happening on revenue and on productivity. And again, that's something I warmly welcome from the SNP, because that's definitely what business and industry has been very concerned about. They want to have economic stability. They want prudent fiscal management. They want lower taxation or a lower tax burden. They want closer alignment of the Scottish taxation with UK taxation. They will want a well-maintained infrastructure, including in rural areas, fewer barriers to trade, and a strong emphasis on training and skills of the sort that Alex Rowley was talking about. Now, Daniel Johnson was quite right, too, because he was flagging up that one of the biggest challenges that we currently face is the extent of economic inactivity, worryingly high rates of inactivity, which obviously means that we are not making the best use of the skills and talents within our labour force. We desperately need the skills of those who are able to work, and therefore the policy perspective should be fully focused on helping those people back into the labour force, preparing them for the future jobs that many people have spoken about in this debate, secure jobs, and on investment. And obviously that... Yes, of course.
Claire Adamson.
So thank you to Liz Smith for taking the intervention. There has been a lot of discussion from across the benches about the skills base and about those opportunities for young people. But how on earth does the Tory and Labour policy adopted by Keir Starmer and Rishi Sunak not to take the offer of the European Commission of a free movement arrangement with under 30s, how does that help in this situation? Because obviously we want to attract opportunities for young people here, but we also want our young people to have the opportunities to study and work abroad.
Liz
as
Smith.
Well.
Claire Adamson, who made a good speech on the aspect of technology, and just point her to Murdo Fraser's earlier remarks about the immigration. But I'm on record in this Parliament several times as saying that I think we need to look at this whole area about attracting more young people. And I would gently point out to Claire Adamson that it was the SNP government who made quite a substantial cut to the economy budget, 8.3% in real terms, and that was including to the enterprise and employability budget. So I don't think it's fair just to blame Westminster. And I also have to point out that I think it was 9% was the figure within the business community a few months ago who were saying that the Scottish Government was not particularly sympathetic to their concerns. So I think all of these issues are very important. But can I just say a little bit about tax? And I'm not going to be allowed to, I don't think, by the Deputy Presiding Officer to talk from an electioneering point of view, because that's not right. But I do think the tax aspect is absolutely critical, because it goes hand in hand with the incentives to develop economic growth. And we can't have debates on economic growth without also mentioning the tax burden. And I suspect that Kate Forbes and I have more in common on that than perhaps some of her colleagues, because I think the Deputy First Minister does understand that recent progressive taxation, as set out by the SNP, has not been satisfactory in terms of people being encouraged to come to highly skilled jobs in Scotland. Mr Brown wants to intervene, I think.
Keith Brown.
Can I
Yeah, can I thank Liz Smith for taking the intervention? And given what she's just said, would she agree that there can be no incentive in the idea that personal allowances for tax are to be frozen for the next 3 years? That amounts to a tax increase, but that is the current plans of both the Labour and Conservative Party. Surely that's not a good thing.
Mr Brown, I think it's much more about the differentials. That's the point that we're discussing just now. The differentials are a serious disincentive for many people who want to come to Scotland to work in our higher paid jobs. And I think that's something that we have to reflect on, because I think that's very important. And you know, I've heard the SNP on several occasions say that this is all offset by the fact that there's free prescriptions or free tuition, for example. The fact of the matter is that's not actually free. It's not free at all. It's about who pays for it. And therefore, the debate about universal benefits, I think, is something that is going to, in light of what the Scottish Fiscal Commission has said, that is a debate that is going to have to happen. And I think all parties, there is an increasing number of people in this chamber who agree that that debate is going to have to happen. So can I just finish, Presiding Officer, on the fact that there was nothing in the SNP motion that we could disagree with. I welcome the fact that there's a different tone to this kind of debate. But I do think that in terms of adding to the debate, that tax issue is absolutely critical. And that's the reason why I'm supporting the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. And I call on Tom Arthur to wind up the debate. Up to 9 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I take this opportunity to thank colleagues from across the chamber for their contributions? I think there has actually been broad consensus this afternoon, and even in those areas where consensus might not be immediately apparent, I think nonetheless there has been a great deal of alignment, and I'll see if I can surface some of that in my remarks. I'm going to just begin by taking a few of the contributions in turn, because I think there's much that merits further consideration. I want to welcome the tone from Murdo Fraser and indeed from Liz Smith in this debate. And I also want to recognise the point that Mr Fraser made, which is that rhetoric is one thing, actions are another. And I know that is something that business is watching very carefully to see the actions that the government takes. And we are having that very close engagement. Members will obviously appreciate the limitations placed upon the government during the pre-election period with that regard. But we want to build upon the work that has been gained through the New Deal with business and what that has brought in terms of benefits through very close collaboration. Indeed, Mr Fraser touched on the issue of regulation, something I know is of particular concern to him, but also to a number of sectors. And he raised a number of examples. And we are working very closely with industry through the work on the Regulation Improvement Advisory Group and indeed the Regulatory Review Group, and looking at how we can enhance the BIA process, particularly to take that point around cumulative impact into consideration. I'm happy to give way if a member.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way, and I welcome what he had to say. I wonder if you might say something about the issue of planning, which both Mr Ewing and I raised, because I think this is absolutely crucial in terms of unlocking our economic potential if we can remove some of the blockages in the planning system.
Minister.
Mr Fraser anticipates the next matter about which I'm about to turn to. One thing that Mr Fraser said, and I was actually heartened by, was, I'm sure you'll correct me if I misunderstood him, but that it's not policy or law that is the issue, but it's a question of processing and time. And I think that's very important, because I'm conscious, particularly as a former planning minister, of the significant importance planning has for our economy. Indeed, it's perhaps sometimes can be overlooked as one of the most powerful economic tools we have under the devolution settlement, the regulation of the use of land. And it is important to remember that the planning system in its infancy was born out of concerns around public health, and we from history know the consequences of unplanned settlements, the squalor that characterised Victorian and early Edwardian towns and cities. And we also know the consequences of planning decisions that have been poor. We recognise the good intent of post-war redevelopment, but ultimately in terms of some of the ways in addressing the housing crisis at the end of the Second World War actually created more problems than it solved. So good planning and good policy is important, but I agree for certainty and to attract investment It is absolutely important. It's of fundamental importance that we have a planning system that is efficient. I'll give way in just a moment. And to that regard, we do face challenges. We all are aware of the challenges around recruitment and retention of planners within local government. And that is why the government has been taking forward work, and I know that my colleague Ivan McKee, as the minister responsible for planning, is leading on about how we attract more people into the planning profession, but also consider ways in which we can use the central resource of government to support expeditious decision-making within the planning system. I'm happy to give way to Mr Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the minister for doing so. I think he highlights the very important reasons why we introduced the planning system, but they're very much domestic ones. The reality is that some of the challenges we face now are very much international and global pressures, and the reality is it's taking us 7, 8, 9 years to get planning consents through for large offshore wind, where in other countries such as Norway it's 2 to 3. So I wonder what he made of Fergus Ewing's suggestion about timely decisions, but also international benchmarking of those same decisions.
Minister.
I think in that international competition for investment, being able to understand how we compare internationally is of fundamental importance. And on policy with the National Planning Framework 4, I may be somewhat paraphrasing, but industry commented that it was one of the most supportive planning regimes for renewables anywhere in Europe. But I take the point that policy is one thing, the actual capacity for decision-making is another. Taxation has been another feature of this debate, Presiding Officer. In particular, the tax differential that exists on income tax between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom. I'm not going to rehearse the arguments that we've had many times before, and I'm sure we'll have again, but I would note that the decisions that we have taken in Scotland mean that we do have an additional £1.5 billion of revenue available for public services, which is helping to support investment in our health service and also investment in policies like the Scottish Child Payment, which is part of a suite of measures that's helping to keep an estimated 100,000 children out of poverty. And tackling child poverty, indeed eradicating child poverty, it is, of course, a moral imperative. It is something that we have a statutory obligation to meet, but it is also an investment in the labour market of the future. And I think that is something as well we should recognise. It is a significant economic investment in our people, the future of our country. Fergus Ewing also, in his intervention, touched on the oil and gas sector, and the key issue of a just transition has come up. That is something that is of fundamental importance to us all. And I say this as the constituency MSP for Lynwood. I am acutely aware of the consequences of an unjust transition when deindustrialisation without a proper plan for what comes next is implemented and the catastrophic legacy that it can leave. So it is imperative that in ensuring we deliver that just transition, we do so in a way that takes people with us. I'll give way to Mr Ewing.
Fergus Ewing.
Very grateful to the Minister for giving way. Does he agree that the facts show that amongst the leading investors in the world in hydrogen, in carbon capture, transportation and storage, are companies, major oil and gas companies and private equity funds that fund them, companies such as BP, Shell and Equinor, and that their commitment and their investment and their skills are simply a sine qua non to making success of a homegrown energy transition?
Minister.
Yes, I do. And it is imperative that we harness these skills because we're quite aware, I think we're all acutely aware, that there is simply not the capital available within the public sector, and certainly not within the devolved settlement, for that capital funding to be met from the taxpayer alone. I certainly want to encourage any incoming Labour administration to be more ambitious in their funding, but even with that, we will still require significant amounts of capital investment. I want to turn just to Maggie Chapman's contribution as well, which I thought was incredibly thoughtful and considered, and posed some challenges that have been picked up by other members as well, which is while growth is a necessity, it is not sufficient, and we have to take into account as well growth for what particular purpose. What are the ends that we are trying to achieve? So that is something that is very much at the centre of our thinking on economics. That fundamental question of how we ensure that our economy delivers well-being for people across Scotland. I'm conscious that some critics may wish to characterise that the notion of well-being as something nebulous, but it is no more nebulous than obsessions with utility and rational actors performing with perfect information. So that question about how we innovate in our economic thinking, that is something that is an international concern at the moment. How we think about GDP plus and ensure that rather than having a model where we effectively allow the negative externalities to mount up and then address through redistribution, we can seek to address them at source through things, for example, embedding fair work and sustainability in absolutely everything we do. Presiding Officer, I'm very conscious that time is rapidly drawing to a close. I would just want to pick up on one or two final points. Claire Adamson highlighted the importance of the fourth industrial revolution that we are currently undergoing, and indeed the vital importance of the gaming sector in Scotland, something we can be rightfully proud of. And I would just want to remind Claire Adamson that the Scottish Government is collaborating with industry stakeholders to create a national action plan for games. Again, Presiding Officer, I thank members for their contribution this afternoon, and I would encourage them to support the Government motion.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Scottish Government priorities, growing the economy. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Business Motion 13696 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on Alexander Burnett to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you, Mr. Burnett. No member has asked to speak to the motion, and the question is that motion 13696 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that amendment 13679.2 in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend motion 13679 in the name of Kate Forbes on Scottish Government priorities growing the economy be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.